Throughout the previous series, we saw how Japan underwent a vast evolution as the Shogun and the Samurai came to rule the country. Now, in the 1400s, we find ourselves in the midst of the Muromachi period, when the Ashikaga Shogunate ruled from Kyoto. Although we know how we got to this point, let us now take a closer look into what Japan and the Samurai actually looked like during the 15th century. In the early years of the 1400s, Japan was under the control of Shogun Yoshimochi, who governed from his lavish palace of Hana no Gosho on Muromachi Street in Kyoto. Yoshimochi had the unfortunate honor of ruling after his father, the great Ashikaga Yoshimitsu, who can be remembered as a shrewd and expert politician, as he saw to the disestablishment of Go-Daigo's southern imperial court in 1392. Yoshimochi, on the other hand, was no great politician or powerful figurehead. Instead, he and the Ashikaga shoguns who would follow would usher in the grand decline of their power. This was due to a couple of reasons. One being that many clans did not view the Ashikaga shogunate with the same level of respect that they had viewed the Kamakura shogunate. Most clans had owed their loyalty to the Kamakura shogunate because they had been given their land by the Kamakura. But now that the Ashikaga were responsible for the distribution and redistribution of land to all of the clans, they had little need to ever do so. This of course meant that many clans had no reason to feel bound to the Ashikaga shogunate, causing the various lords to have little reason to respect or follow the orders of the shogun. Early on, the shogunate attempted to remedy this issue by waging war against clans who still supported the southern court. The Ashikaga shogunate directly ruled roughly one quarter of the country and attempted to use their strength to finish off the southern court loyalists. This would allow them to gift freshly claimed land to clans who aided them during war, thus creating a respectable level of loyalty and stability. Unfortunately, these attempts against Southern Court loyalists would prove somewhat ineffective and costly, making the authority of the Ashikaga shogunate seem weak. Still, what power was absent in the capital was more than made up for by the vast expansion of art and culture throughout the Muromachi period. While the arts flourished in the stagnant capital, the clans, however, began to transform. Shugo, or provincial clan lords, who were military governors that were appointed by the Kamakura shogunate, were now beginning to view their positions as more autonomous, due to the apparently weak grip of the shogun. Many shugo began mustering larger armies in aims to consolidate their land holdings. Of course, many of which also started to grow ambitious as well, coveting lands from their neighboring clans, knowing full well that the Ashikaga shogunate would be less than able to stop their increasing might. It would only be a matter of time before new wars between clans would erupt throughout the country. It would be these new powerful and ambitious shugo that would begin to be known as the first of the daimyo, the feudal clan lords who would one day vie for control of the country. However, A failsafe had been initiated by the Shogunate early on, making it so that the Shugo would need to maintain a residence in Kyoto, limiting their ability to actually act out against the Shogun's authority. Yet this too began to fall apart in time, as the Shugo would soon appoint relatives or retainers to take up their positions in Kyoto instead. This allowed the clans to continue growing in strength. Throughout the 1400s, further evolution came in the face of the samurai themselves. One of the primary changes being in the way of the sword. During the Mongol invasions of the late 1200s, the samurai found their tachi to be somewhat ineffective in several scenarios against their Mongol enemies. The first issue was that the tachi sword was not able to easily cut through the boiled leather armor of the Mongol infantry. The second issue was the length of the tachi becoming problematic when fighting in close proximity. These dilemmas, coupled with other minor annoyances, paved the way for the development of new, shorter blades. This, of course, meant the introduction of the katana, and later, the wakizashi short sword. By the 1400s, these two swords were quickly becoming widely used by the samurai class, as they would become a staple of samurai status. Armor in Japan was also evolving, as the early styles began changing to allow for further flexibility and protection, while at the same time allowing for greater ornamentation and distinction, which would in turn see to better recognition for specific lords and samurai. By the 1460s, the progression of the daimyo and the samurai would finally lead to the inevitable, a war which would set off nearly 150 years of conflict. However, the cause of this war would in fact come from a most unforeseen source. In the next video, we will see the outbreak of the Onin War. Thank you for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most informative.